Oh, good morning. This is a rarity. Taping in the morning. But it's important to get right into the content that I was able to bring into focus early this morning. Regarding the overlay and the world. The overlay is not interested in the world. What is not interested. What is. The overlay is. It is not being modified or changed. It's not interested in modification or change. It knows that it is. It's an effect which is not trying to negate itself. It's an effect that comes from an idea of non-negation. So there's no need, there's no call, there's no purpose for any negation of that effect. It's not an effect that's involved in trying to negate itself. Unlike this world here. So the overlay has zero interest in anything that's taking place here in this world. Because what's taking place here in this world is simply a play of supposition that what is can be modified, that reality can be modified or changed. And what is not interested in such fanciful suppositions and assumptions and false beliefs. So as we look at the overlay, we must remind ourselves that is the only remedy for our troubles. I've said that in many other videos. The overlay is not interested in other efforts, in any efforts, one way or the other. It's not interested in what's being done, nor what's not being done. It's not interested in what's being said, or what's not being said. It's not interested in any attainments or non-attainments. It's not interested that any of us are getting insight or failing to get insight. It's not interested even in what any guru is saying or not saying, or any guru is doing or not doing. You could have the highest teacher guru in the world, and they're going about holding satsang and giving advice and etc. The overlay has no interest in that. The overlay is not interested in any prayers that are being said or not being said. It's not interested in any births or any deaths. Overlay has zero interest. Doesn't have interest. It is. It's not concerned about ideas of what it isn't or isn'tness. There's no concern of that. And only that reminds us of what we really are, because what we really are is we are spirit, extension of the mind of God, extension of the Prime Creator. And ideas are not modified by their effects. And only a perfect reminder of what we are will free us from that deep, deep forgetfulness of what we are, that we've been pursuing, that this world is showcasing to us. So, it's extremely important to look at the overlay and then realize that it has no interest at all in anything that's taking place in this world. Even the highest events, even the greatest insights, it's not interested in your enlightenment. It's not interested that somebody was enlightened or not enlightened. The only purpose of the overlay is to give a perfect remembrance of what we really are. The goal of endeavor here in this world, the true goal is to choose the overlay and be reminded, perfectly reminded of what we are. And only that is the remedy for the troubles that we have, which is this deep forgetfulness. The overlay is not concerned who's being treated fairly and who's being treated unfairly. It's not interested in pursuing justice. It's not interested that someone wrote a book, or what's being said or written, and what language it's being expressed in or not expressed in. All expressions and all non-expressions have no interest to the overlay. The overlay has no interest. It's not interested in you, in me, in any guru, teacher. It's not even interested in God, Prime Creator. Not interested. The overlay simply is. It overlays all effects and remains unmodified. Means seamless, totally at peace, undisturbed. And that then reminds us of what we are. And by remembering of what we are, we also then remember the Prime Creator. Prime Creator is not concerned about opinions about the Prime Creator. High opinions, low opinions, makes no difference, because that's not true remembrance. It doesn't matter what we say, what we think, what we do. It's all irrelevant. The overlay is, it is right now. It is, overlays all time and space. It's exactly the same right now as any other point in time and space. Exactly the same. It's always been exactly the same, always will be exactly the same. So it's not interested in change. You might say the overlay is perfectly indifferent to anything, any situation. Nothing that occurs makes any difference to it. Whether someone realizes the overlay, choose it or not choose it, it's also indifferent to that. Success or failure, indifferent to that. It's this flawless indifference to modifications or changes of any type, even what we would call great changes, positive changes, indifferent to that. So what we're talking about here is an actual, true, perfect reminder of what we really are. And that is that which has no concern about being modified or changed, because it cannot be modified or changed. That is our condition. We need to be reminded of that, because we have fallen into this deep sleep of forgetfulness, and in this deep sleep of forgetfulness, we believe that what we are can be changed or modified. So the remedy has to be, we have to be reminded that what we are cannot be changed or modified. And it's not even the slightest bit concerned about being changed or modified. It has zero interest in that. It has no interest in the impossible. And why should it? Why should we have interest in the impossible? What kind of interest could be meaningful? So, the purpose of satsang is to bring up these very stark facts. And of course, it cuts through a lot of delay. And we may think, whoa, you know, what do I do with all this other stuff that I've been working on? It's not important what's done with it. Whether you do something with it or don't do something with it, doesn't matter. The overlay is not concerned with that. The overlay has no concern. It's already there. It's already present. It's at hand. It's right here. It's always been present. That's always, it is. It's not in a process of becoming. It's not interested in any processes of becoming. Those have zero relevance. So we get to choose between what is, that which is, and all our interest in something else. Because we can only experience what is. We cannot be interested in it. This interest in it isn't it. Because it's not interested in our interest. That's the truth. So this morning I've seen all of this. The overlay is not even interested in whether we are talking about the overlay or not. Its presence is sufficient. It knows that. It's the Holy Spirit, or the grace of God, voice of reason, which is talking about this, which is interested in it. But it knows that it's just temporary. It's just a device, just a tool to be set down once we choose to experience, to abide in the overlay. For instance, A Course in Miracles said its main purpose is to make itself obsolete so that we can set it down completely and overlook it completely. That's its main purpose. It said when it's accomplished that, then it's accomplished its purpose to say, I have no more need for that, no more interest. It has no use for me whatsoever, zero. I have no interest in it. So that's its actual goal. Set it down for the vision of Christ, meaning the overlay, vision of oneness. Set it aside. Makes no difference whether you understand it or not. Completely irrelevant. But to recognize that it is irrelevant is the purpose of it. To recognize that everything is irrelevant is the purpose of the spiritual path. It's not relevant to what is. All this world of supposition of what might be, that maybe we can modify what is, that's irrelevant to what is. It's irrelevant. Lies are irrelevant to truth. What interest does truth have in lies? None. The overlay has no interest at all in what's taking place here or anywhere else, because it's already overlaid everything that could ever arise or ever take place. It overlays all effects, all dreams. It overlays all dreams, all imaginings, all suppositions, all notions of modification. Because it came from an idea of no negation, no desire to be prime creator, no desire to modify anything. So this effect is not engaged in any modification. It's not interested in any modification. And that includes in any direction, positive, negative, whatever you want to call it. It's not interested in saying, someone's saying, hey, I'm enlightened. It's not interested in that. It just is. It's just there to be experienced. Whether we choose to experience it or not. Again, that's a choice that our spirit makes. But the effect is not interested in our choice one way or the other, because it knows that it is. and our choice one way or the other, it won't change the overlay one bit. And so you have this type of teaching, which for me it feels very valid. It's a huge step forward to see it in this way, to hear this type of teaching. Not that the overlay is at least a bit interested in it, but since we have what's called interest, meaning interest in modification, we have to use that interest to point in the right direction that shows point towards that which has no interest in interest. And to see that it has no interest because it needs no interest. Because it already, it knows what it is, and there's no modification of what it is taking place. And so we have the option to experience that. To choose to experience that. Now the dance of modification continues in existence. But we can be indifferent to it. High indifference. More than indifferent. Simply is. To experience isness. Rather than the supposed modification of isness. That's the only choice we have. It's the only choice there is. Choosing to continue to focus on modifications. That's doing exactly what we've always been doing here. It's not a change. It's not a choice. It's not choosing something different. It's choosing the same old. So we can only choose either between supposed modifications of isness, of what is, or choose to experience what is. That which cannot be modified. There's no modification taking place. It cannot be modified because the idea that gave rise to it is not an idea of trying to modify what is. The dance of supposed modification is called the dance of Maya, the dance of delusion, illusion, etc., great illusion. That all arises from the idea of spirit trying to be prime creator, wanting to be prime creator, which means modifying what is, trying to change what is, trying to reverse the direction of creation. Instead of prime creator extending itself as spirit, spirit wants to be extending itself as prime creator. That's an attempt to modify, change what is. So of course we have this vast scenario of modifications, constant modifications in all different directions, and we try to find meaning in those, but there's no meaning whatsoever. It's all flat, it's all zero. Because it's all suppositions that are not true. What is cannot be modified. Reality cannot be modified or changed. Direction of creation cannot be changed. Therefore, everything, this dance of supposed modification, is really nothing. It's flat. It's zero. And even getting it that it's flat or zero is also flat and zero. Being interested in that it's flat and zero is also flat and zero. So we can bring ourselves right up to the stepping off point of choosing to experience isness. We can bring ourselves right up to that conceptually. It's possible, which is what we're doing right here, bringing ourselves right up to isness, choosing isness, being interested in choosing it, but that's only based on modifying our previous lack of interest, our lesser interest. So we're modifying that and modifying that. And we believe that's important. Now we believe it's not important. It has no use. It's still zero. We believe that our clarity and interest had some importance. Now we see it has zero importance as far as experiencing isness is concerned. It's just still zero. We see that. But that seeing that is still a zero. And that satsang brings us up to seeing that whatever we do in satsang is still a zero. Whether we get it or not is still a zero. Because experiencing, choosing the isness is indifferent to any success or failure, one way or the other. That's not the point of it at all. Isness is not saying, oh, I'm so happy you chose isness. No. Because still that is talking about a modification or change. The quality of the isness is that it overlays everything equally. It's not interested. There's no interest there. So it's beyond what we can imagine. Because imagination really is really modification. Even the highest clarity cannot really get it. Still zero. But the purpose of the highest clarity is to see that it's still a zero. That brings us to the doorstep. So all that satsang can do is bring us to the doorstep. Cannot get us to go through the door. Because really there is no going through the door. From the standpoint of isness, there is no going through the door. In other words, there is no success, there is no enlightenment. from the standpoint of the isness, from the overlay, there is no such thing as success. There is no enlightenment. There is no such notions. So ultimately, in going across the threshold, one gives up any notion of success or failure. That belong to dreams. So repeatedly, it's important to continue to bring this fact up. Get used to it, see it, and ask if that is something that we want or not. Because if we say we're enlightened, what does that mean compared to what? It's still a comparison. It means the notion of unenlightenment is also there with us. That we were not enlightened, but now we are. Time is there. None of that is actually experiencing the isness. Experiencing the isness is not concerned whether we're claiming to be enlightened or not. The isness just is. So we can move ourselves, move our, what we want, move it close, closer and closer and closer. That's all we can do as far as using words, as far as looking at the situation. And since we are having satsang, that is what we're doing. That is what we must do. So we can bring up examples. Almost exercises like, now let's say we've chose to experience the isness, the overlay. Let's say someone is shouting that Jesus has returned, he's over here, and he's speaking. Does the overlay have any interest in that? None. The overlay is what it is. It's not trying to be something else. It's not saying, oh, I am the overlay. I am this perfect, peaceful, seamless overlay. But Jesus is speaking in existence, so I need to be interested in that and forget what I am. No. course the ego will say those things that, oh, there's something really important happening. You know, from the standpoint of isness, there's nothing important happening. The whole importance has no meaning. There's nothing important happening from the standpoint of the overlay, because the overlay knows that it overlays that. That it's the same. It's unaffected by important happenings or unimportant happenings. So if Jesus were to come here and even be holding satsang, the overlay is unconcerned about that. It has no interest in it. It has neither interest nor disinterest. It overlays that. It doesn't see it any different than anything else. It doesn't make any distinctions. Isness doesn't make distinctions. Because what kind of distinctions could be meaningful to isness, to what is, to what is true? Is truth spending its time making distinctions? Well, this is more true than this, and this is less true than that. No, it doesn't do that. So the play of the mind can never, in the context of the idea of trying to be prime creator, that play can never truly remind us of what we are, no matter how it plays. So how it plays is unimportant for the purposes of being minded of what we are. It has no use, no utility. We have to experience isness, what is, unmodifiedness. We must experience that. And even if in experiencing that, the overlay, if the whole world were suddenly to gather in a massive satsang of raising consciousness and say this is the most important thing that's ever happened, etc., that has zero importance to the overlay. Overlay is not in the slightest bit interested in that. You might say it's neither interested nor disinterested. The issue of interest doesn't even arise. That's Ananda Mai Ma said, when asked what she was, she said, you know, even though all this play that is taking place, dancing in the halls of eternity, what I am remains exactly the same. Before all that, during that, after all that, remain exactly the same. That's isness. None of this touches that at all. Doesn't change it in any way. So when a teacher comes into this world, truly the real importance is the presence of this isness. What they say, what they do, doesn't really matter. Only look and see is the presence of isness, the overlay, is it there? If it's there, it's there. If it's not there, it doesn't matter what they say or do. It's not there. And ultimately, what their purpose is, any teacher's purpose is to get us to go beyond anything the teacher says or does, go beyond the teacher itself, and into the experiencing of the presence, experiencing the overlay, the actual experience of it. Any book, any teaching there ever will ever be has the exact same purpose, is to, for us to transcend that, to set it down, and choose instead of that, and choose the overlay, choose the vision of oneness. That's the only purpose there is for it, is to guide us, point us in the right direction, and say, okay, go beyond any teacher or teaching. Buddhism says the same thing. If you see the Buddha on the path, kill the Buddha. In other words, Don't be delayed. Don't pay attention to that, to the Buddha. Buddha didn't come into the world saying, pay attention to Buddha. He said, choose the overlay. Choose the vision of oneness. Choose nirvana. Ananda Maima said, you know, everything I'm saying and doing, that's all just a play that you want to see. You want to see this play, so the play arises for you. But she says, what I am is untouched, unmodified by any play. So it's the statement, what I am, what is not modified, modifiable. And dreams of its modification don't modify it. The fact that isness sees all of existence seem is flat in comparison to isness doesn't mean that isness is, itself is flat. It's you know, because it doesn't have any interest, does that mean it's bored or it's flat? No. Doesn't need to recognize, it's not recognizing that something is flat. It simply is. It's unchangeable, unmodifiable, and it's eternal. Eternally rich in what it is. It's a reminder of what we are, and what we are is access to all experiencing, all ideas. So there's no flatness to what we are at all. None. So the dimension of the overlay is endlessness itself. It overlays all effects. So there is that... excuse me. The purpose of the overlay is that of a reminder of what we are. So it has perfect utility for that. And in reminding us of what we are, that is also a reminder of the infinite riches of what we are. So the overlay does have depth. The reminder of depth does have depth. Because we are the ones that remember. And in remembering what we are, the overlay is included in that remembrance, like a blessing upon it. Upon it. Excuse me, my voice is early morning voice. And even though we can't speak clearly about this exactly right now, we'll be able to. We might be able to look into this. But we can intuitively sense it. The overlay is not flat. It overlays flatness. But it itself is not flat, because it doesn't leave its source. And its source is the idea of non-negation, which means letting what is be what is, which means letting reality be reality. And reality has infinite depth to it, endless depth to it, endless richness to it. It's an interesting question, though, for us right now. Is the overlay of total flatness, is that itself totally flat? And we don't need to get lost in that, because intuitively we know now that resolves also. So even in looking at this, we're not bothered by it. I don't feel bothered by bringing up all of this. It's not bothersome. It's in a funny way, it's interesting. The fact that the overlay has no interest is interesting. There's an attraction to it. We kind of say, yeah, I want that which is not interested in interest, doesn't care, is indifferent. That high indifference is very attractive. If we choose the overlay to feel this perfect, flawless, unchangeable peace, seamless peace, and someone says, oh, you're enlightened, and I'm going to go over here and tell the world how enlightened you are, and you need to show up there to receive all the accolades, etc. There's no interest in that. That's very compelling. And so, this is the purpose of satsang, is to fly around, around all of this, hover around this like a helicopter, taking a flight over some terrain, some landscape, like a Hawaiian helicopter ride, going along the cliffs, and then it swings up above the cliffs and into the mountains in the backcountry, etc. And you get to see the lay of the land. And by seeing the lay of the land that quickly, maybe in a 10-minute ride, you've seen all the lay of this land, the rugged landscape, and you say, ah, I know what's there. Changes one's perspective. I'm not so worried anymore about it. The high indifference, the overlay is already here. It will never be modified. It's here exactly the way it will always be here. Exactly the way it's always been here. No modification taking place whatsoever. All the mantras and all the prayers, all the meditations and asanas and sadhanas and whatever we do, that will not modify the overlay in the slightest bit. Will not change it in the slightest bit. And so what are we waiting for? What exactly are all these prayers and mantras and doing for us? Choosing the overlay is the remedy. The overlay is exactly here, exactly the way it will always be. It will never be modified in any way. So what utility does anything that we're doing have? How is it benefiting us? It doesn't really benefit us at all. Not actually. It's a response to the attraction we're feeling. But only choosing to experience the overlay is the benefit. Trying to symbolize our attraction to it is not the benefit. We might feel this very strong attraction and we want to compose a poem, a spiritual poem that captures the essence of this attraction, or we want to compose some music that symbolizes this somehow to us. that glorifies the feeling of attraction we have. We say, oh, God, you are great. And let me give this prayer to how great this is, the attraction I'm feeling to you, so wonderful, etc. What is that really? Does that actually remind us of what we are? No, it does not. Is the overlay interested in having poems written about it and songs and all this glorification of it? No, it is not. Has zero interest in that. Has zero interest. It doesn't have interest. Is the overlay saying, oh, I'm so happy that you're writing, you know, books and books and books full of flowery, beautiful praise of the overlay. Is the overlay interested or happy about that? No. Not one bit. Neither happy nor not happy. Neither interested nor disinterested. The overlay simply is what it is. It's there exactly as it always will be, unmodifiable. So it's useless to try and amplify the overlay, to sing praises of it as if that somehow is amplifying it or doing something to it or making it better. The overlay is not modifiable. It's exactly the way that it is right now is the way that it always is. So no mantra changes that. So what are we doing with all the mantras and prayers? Trying to boost our courage, basically. Trying to somehow choose the overlay. That's what we're really doing. But we may not be conscious of that. It may not be the most direct way, really. Looking at it like this, I believe, is the best way. Just simple, direct gazing at that situation. What have we been doing? Why has it been ineffective? And then seeing it will always be ineffective. When we see something we're doing will always be ineffective, what do? We're, of course, we're closer to giving it up. And singing the praises of the overlay is ineffective because it's not experiencing the overlay. Only experiencing it is effective. We can be on the doorstep chanting and singing and dancing and singing the praises and building temples, holding satsang, the whole range of things, you know, composing glorifications of all different types, doing rituals, etc. We can do that for endlessly. That's of no use. None. Zero. Still completely zero. And in seeing this, we're prone to cut through the delay, right? We're saying, oh boy, I'm not going to keep on doing a zero, however beautiful that zero is, however beautiful the frame is. We keep making beautiful frames around a picture, a blank picture of zero. It has no utility for us, none, zero utility, because it doesn't remind us of what we are. Remember, the remembrance of what we are has to be flawless and perfect. Otherwise, it will not remind us of what we are. It will remind us of a supposed modification of what we are, which is not what we are at all, which has no relevance to what we are whatsoever, zero. There's no lie that is true. There's no modification of the self whatsoever. So, remembrance of a supposed modification of the self is deep, deep forgetfulness of what we are. And all these glorifications of attraction to what we are, etc., that doesn't remind us of what we are. Because all those things are based on modifications. Music is choosing this note and not choosing that one. But what is not choosing one thing and not choosing another, etc. Like, not like that. It's not stringing together a process. Music strings together notes. Poems string together words. None of that is the overlay. Only this seamless overlay of all effects, of all suppositions, of all belief in becoming, all belief in doing, all interests and disinterests. Only that overlay is the flawless, perfect reminder. Only that. Only that. And so as we sing and dance on the doorstep, we need to look at that and say that that has no utility. It's complete nothing. Zero. Again, and in seeing that it's zero, that cuts through the delay for us, which is what we want. Our problem is one of delay. That's the only problem there is. It's one of delay. We're simply delaying our experiencing of the vision of oneness, vision of Christ overlay. We're simply delaying that. So we need to look at the delay and cut through it and realize, see it. And the most crucial delay, again, is the most beautiful delay. The delay that has the most beautiful frames on it. That's the one that's holding us up. And the most beautiful frames will be the ones that glorify, that spend time glorifying the overlay, but not experiencing it. See, that's delay. That's still zero. We can spend time building infinite churches and temples and ashrams and synagogues and places of worship of all different types. We can spend infinite time making beautiful things, ornamenting all these places, writing beautiful books, beautiful hymns, songs, chants, mantras, prayers of all types. We can spend our time doing infinite rituals, beautiful rituals of all different types of incense and flowers and songs and everything. We can spend infinite time doing all that. And we, after spending all that time, we will realize it's all been absolutely zero. We've done nothing. We've gotten nowhere. We have no remembrance of what we are. Zero. Zero, zero, zero. We've only spent our time trying to be reminded of what we're not. Trying to be reminded of a modification of what we are. Even if it's a supposed subtle modification. So all we're doing here is looking at delay, bringing delay to light. The ultimate teacher is the one who has chosen to experience the overlay, and that presence is there, and that's the ultimate. Next to that is the ones who are able to focus on delay effectively and look at the delay and see it. That's what I'm doing here. I was told by one of my teachers that I'm a mid-level teacher, meaning I'm able to focus on the delay, even the highest forms of delay, the most seductive, attractive forms of delay, and point out that it is a zero. It's still nothing more than any other form of delay. I'm able to do that. I'm doing it right now. So that's what's called a mid-level teacher. Highest teachers are the ones who have chosen to overlay, who are experiencing that or abiding in that. I'm not sure what other types of teachers there are. Maybe the lower level teachers generate a certain general interest in taking a look at stuff, delay in general, kind of generalized type of thing. I'm able to take a look at this, the subtle forms of delay, stuff that really trips us up to the point of the highest type of subtlety and attraction. So I guess that's what constitutes what a mid-level teacher. And then the highest teachers have actually chosen the overlay. Case of Ananda, my ma, she didn't even need to choose the overlay because she never chosen to try and modify what is. So came into the world, as she said, always been the same before she was born, while she was here, after the body passed away, never any change whatsoever. So it is possible for what is to animate a body here. That's very rare. But the high teachers are those who have chosen the overlay. I guess above the highest teachers there is the avatar, who has never been deluded, ever. And that was Ananda Maima, was one of those. You could see the high indifference in her. Those closest to her said, you know, we've been with her for so long, decades and decades, so close to her, and yet she has this complete high indifference. We get the feeling of absolute remoteness, which is really, they're speaking of this complete indifference of isness. And she herself would say she sees zero difference between those who have been closest to her for the longest time and a speck of dust. No difference whatsoever, zero difference. And they felt this extreme, flawless indifference. Which didn't mean she wasn't caring and kind and loving. Of course, all of that was there. But this extreme indifference was there also. That's the quality of the overlay. It's both perfectly compassionate, kind, and loving in all ways, and yet it has zero interest in any modifications, really. It sees existence as completely flat, as it were, as far as value, meaning, etc. Knows that there's no isness, cannot be modified. So there are those avatars who have never been deluded, never fallen into the sleep of forgetfulness. They come here occasionally in the world. Then there are the high teachers who have chosen the overlay, perfect remembrance of what they are. And then there are the mid-level teachers who work on clarifying delay. And then there are the lower-level teachers who work on getting general interest towards the spiritual path, the hard work, orienting towards that general orientation. So in listening to this, you're actually listening to the highest teaching, but that highest teaching is also zero. So I'm aware of that. I'm not deluded into thinking just because I'm giving out the highest teaching that this is it. No. It's zero. It's just clarification. It's the highest clarification, but it's just clarification, which is still a zero. Beyond that is the actual choice to experience the overlay, the isness, which needs no clarification. None whatsoever. And only by seeing this is it possible to actually clarify. Realizing that it is nothing. Like I say, I have no attainment whatsoever. None. Because even the highest clarification is zero attainment. So, but in seeing that, I'm able to then make those clarifications. Saying that, you know, even all talk about God is still zero. I'll talk about Jesus, Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi. It's a zero. All clarification is still zero. And the overlay has no interest in any teachers whatsoever. Not even any interest in any avatars, high teachers. So in working on this, we're working at the highest level of clarification. All these videos are touching upon very high levels of clarification, even the highest level, which this video is touching upon it. And the importance of this is to also see that the highest level of clarification is also zero. Because it's a modification. It's not experiencing isness. It's not experiencing the reminder of what we are. It's telling us what is not the reminder. Okay. Not this, not this, not this, not this. That's a mid-level teacher. It's saying even the highest mantras are not it. Highest prayers, highest contemplations are not it. They're zero. Not only are they not it, they're nothing. They're zero. They have no utility. Zero utility. And we don't need to play the game, say, well, they're getting us closer, so they have some utility. No, they have zero utility. Zero actual utility. None. But that's their purpose. The purpose is to see that they don't have any utility. But that doesn't give them utility. See, that's the part that is, it's not tricky. We don't want to fall into the trap saying, oh, I've realized that I haven't realized. And that's the realization. No, it's not the realization. That realization, too, is nothing. It's only experiencing the overlay is the only utility there is. It's the only thing that's effective. The highest clarity is not effective as far as remembering what we are. It's effective in realizing it's not effective, but that still doesn't carry out our purpose at all. So we have to go through this. We have to look at it. I don't feel deflated by looking at this, saying it's all zero. Because intuitively there's a knowing that it helps drop all continued delay. Eventually all delayed. But the dropping of delay isn't it either. It's experiencing the overlay, that's it. So we might say we've dropped 99% of all delay. That's still a zero. Even if we say we've dropped 100% of delay, that's still zero. It's only the experiencing, the actual experiencing of the overlay that reminds us of what we are. So we can bring ourselves up to the point of saying, well, I've dropped all delay. I've seen that all delay is useless, etc. But that still is no attainment. Zero attainment. Seeing that all attainment, so to speak, is zero, and only experiencing the overlay is it. That's it. That's the only thing that's it. It's only one attainment. Everything else is zero attainment. Seeing that, is necessary. We might say there's necessity to it. But it doesn't remind us of what we are, which is the only thing we must do. So, it's not like we must do this, but it's helpful. It's necessary to see that it's not necessary. That kind of paradox type of situation. Okay. Well, if you've hung in here through all of this, that's really great. It's the highest teaching. And again, the highest teaching is still nothing. It's no attainment. You haven't attained anything. But you might see that you haven't attained anything, which is great. And that in itself is not an attainment either, which is really great. And infinitely regression of that, you can continue that. Seeing that you haven't attained anything is also really great, and you see that that's not an attainment either. No attainment, no attainment, no attainment. The reminder, the overlay, is the reminder, and that is the attainment. Experiencing it is the attainment. That's it. Okay. That's it for this video. Very great. That's it.